times two. The situation demands I bring the hard rhymes through. That's why I'm all times two. Half-past despicable, last man to bring it through. Fast raps and critical.
Welcome to Breakup Gaming Society, America's least responsible board game podcast. This is episode 83. I'm your host and friend, the Colonel Hector Bravado in Starkville, Colorado, welcoming you to my autobiographical explorations of board games, booze, and hip-hop. Oh boy, it's good to be back on the mic and with you again. Talking and writing, that's what I like. The rest of it is torture. I get so wrapped around the axle with website and RSS and mic bullshit, but I won't, you know, remind you of what I stop and remind myself when I get overheated and lose perspective. The trick is to stop fixating on the outcome and just learn to hate the process. How can you possibly disappoint everybody tomorrow unless you take a breath and concentrate on mismanaging what's on your plate now? More proven wisdom. Drink of the week. Our sleepy little town has a new cocktail spot. I tried one of their whiskey drinks and I wrote about it. Game of the week. It's poker. I found out I have a neighbor who competed in the World Series of Poker in 2014. You're going to hear Jeremy's story, and I think he told it well. Track of the week. Nobody ever had quite the sound Black Sheep achieved in their 91 debut, A Wolf in Sheep's Clothing. We're going to look at a deep cut from that one and going to present evidence proving that Drez and DJ producer Mr. Long were American hip-hop originals head to toe. Care to join me downtown for a drink? Drink of the week is what's happening now. If Trinidad's new cocktail and small plate spot, The Hive, does what they set out to do, they will have done this town a service, because in addition to mixologist-grade drink menu in a pretty space, they're promising to go as late as 9 or 10 p.m. on Mondays and Tuesday nights. I like that somebody's not only making use of the Creative Commons, that massive space's long and beautiful bar, but trying to breathe a few sparks into the most forlorn days of Main Street's calendar. I hope it works, because the cocktails do. I say cocktails, but I had two of the same thing, the fine and dandy. It's whiskey, amaretto, and OJ in a highball glass on ice with a sprig of dried thyme. At first, I'm skeptical, getting out of my comfort zone. OJ-based drinks are usually the last thing on my radar, but I want to try one of their, you know, signature mixes, and I'm afraid that the Manhattan is going to be too sweet, which seems to be the case every time I order it anywhere on Earth. So I pivot to something utterly foreign. First sip, I feel nothing but orange juice at first. But then, supporting players step in. I actually have to focus and close my eyes. I'm trying to isolate the whiskey from the amaretto, and I can't. They're doing something new together for which I have no name. Something faintly buttery, nutty, and spicy. You know, the OJ rolls back strong across the taste buds with this harmonic second undertow. It's delicious. It's a surprise. And even, you know, my degraded sense of smell can put the last part together. That thyme sprig garnish can jut into your face a little bit, depending on, you know, how you hold it or drink it, but I'm glad I didn't pull it out, because as I sat the glass down, there's this diaphanous herby whisper at the end, swishing its skirts over the final aftertaste of what's in the glass. It's disarming. My surprise doubles. Why is the room filling up? I came downtown having forgotten not only what day of the week it was, but what week of the month. It's First Friday, when dozens of furtive social cells roll across my field of view like rivulets of water being beaten across a windshield on a rainy night. Much of this town's life is hidden from me, and me from it. Place is so sleepy 9 days out of 10 that First Friday feels like the whole Purgatoire Valley has suddenly been repopulated. Although, I still think I prefer second, third, and fourth Fridays, because there's more parking and less talking. And who knows? If the other drinks on offer are half as good as the fine and dandy, maybe Mondays and Tuesdays may yet contain other surprises. Count on me to get drunk and report back. Next, a preview of next week's game, but mostly we're going to hear a one-of-a-kind story about high-stakes hobbies from a local buddy of mine for Game of the Week. Here we go.
I kicked it, yup, yup, I kicked it, come on, you couldn't bang with this if your name was Gang Kong.
somewhere over Germany, circa 1945, a bunch of planes freeze in the moment before streaking orange death. One group is a formation of 21 American B-24J Liberator bombers in tight quartets. A generous allotment of P-51 Mustangs cluster at various points outside the Liberator's combat boxes. The other group is what scrambled to meet them. 6 Focke-Wulf 190s and 4 ME-163 jets. Now, so scratch that, 2 ME-163s, because the Mustangs disrupted them on their approach, and I guess in the abstract action, the Luftwaffe jets were too fast to shoot down, but the Mustangs did make them waste time and fuel, and they can't attack this turn. The Germans appeared on this attack at the tail end of the big formation. They're barreling out of the bombers' contrails, which they were using for cover on approach. They're so... 2 ME-163s and 3 of the 190s have now committed to an attack vector and they've closed distance. Their guns can touch the bombers and the 50 cal American gunners can sure as hell see them. How many leather thumbs over how many fire buttons? And that's as much as I can tell you because I'm just on page 40 of the 53-page rulebook where I'm learning how collision checks work because I think I've crammed too many fighters into attack spaces. It's likely to be a very bad day for my undertrained and piss-soaked roster as I get my head around how to run GMT Games Storm Above the Reich, which I will revisit in the next episode once I have a better idea of what I'm doing. In the meantime, we're going to tell a different story much closer to home, how my neighbor Jeremy's nearly fatal rock-climbing accident at Garden of the Gods as a teenager in Colorado Springs led him to thrill-seeking in a very different arena, the World Series of Poker 2014. So first, I asked Jeremy, and he obliged me with much indulgence and grace about his accident and what it meant for his life and how it happened. He was very forthcoming about it.
I'm wheelchair bound. I'm sure you noticed. I broke my neck in 2004, and in the summer of 2004, I was in the rehab hospital at Craig Hospital in Inglewood, Colorado, a suburb of Denver. Great hospital, one of the best in the nation. And every Sunday we were playing poker. I was there for several months after my injury.
So naturally, my curiosity goes off the charts because I'm curious to know about how Jeremy inhabits his new world and what are some of the mechanics and challenges by which his thrill-seeking goes from outdoor sports to poker hands.
So let me kind of give your audience an idea of the level of my dexterity. So I'm considered, generally referred to as quadriplegic or tetraplegic, which means that all four limbs are paralyzed, although not completely. So I have, for instance, biceps. I can lift my arm up to my face, but I can't really move my fingers individually. I can kind of move my wrist up and down. So I'm a lot stronger now than I was then. But for instance, if I had a pillow on my lap and someone set the cards on my lap, I could push, get a peek at them. I think that's the method I was typically using back then. Although I really can't remember for sure. I know that they had assistive devices, like little racks that you could just set your cards up in. Mm-hmm. But I don't think I use that for very long because, someone can too easily see around the corner, whether intentionally or unintentionally.
I asked Jeremy how comfortable he'd be going a little bit back in time from that and talking about the accident itself. This is what he told me.
I was rock climbing Garden of the Gods, which was a few blocks away from my house. So I could just take a quick bike ride up there. It took me maybe 5 minutes maximum to get from my house to the bottom of Grey Rock, which is the southernmost of the three big rock formations there in the park.
And you're doing technical climbs there?
Yeah, I had gone every Wednesday. I was going with a partner and equipment, and this was a Monday. We'd just gotten back. We were at, I had gone with my family to Hot Springs, Cottonwood Hot Springs. And we got back and I looked outside and it was the most beautiful sunset. And I grabbed my camera, jumped on my bike, and went over there because I was pretty into photography at the time. And I climbed up as fast as I could because I wanted to get a picture of the sunset from the top of Grey Rock, also referred to as Cathedral Rock, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, it was like a 5'9", which is not, for those who don't climb, it's you would never try it. So it's certainly not a, it's not a walk, it's not a hike, it's a pretty technical climb. Yeah, I did it without equipment.
No anchor points, no harnesses. You were just, it was just you and your hands and your chalk and your feet.
Right, no chalk either, but I had been climbing in the same area, like I said, the Wednesday before. It was not a particularly difficult climb. It certainly wasn't like the top of my skill level. It was probably more like a 5'8", honestly. I had done too much climbing to be scared enough, unfortunately. I had lost my rational fear, and you know, when you're 17, and I say it's when you're 17, but honestly, I'm probably just not that good at assessing risk. I'm a little too optimistic. You know, 1 in 1,000 is not very good odds when you don't win millions of dollars. So, you know, if you make it to the top, you have fun and you don't wind up in a hospital. But on that 1,000th time, you know, it's not worth it. I would go back. If I could go back, I would change it, certainly.
And of course, you know, naturally, I want to know more about that progression of how Jeremy gets from playing a few friendly hands in Craig Hospital in Littleton to a World Series of poker table. When do you decide you're ready for that? He talked to me about it.
The money speaks for itself. You're ready when you have the money and the confidence. I played online, little tournaments and free tournaments quite a bit. I was playing those bar tournaments. I would play at home games in Colorado Springs. And that went on for a couple of years. You know, I would, whenever I'd have $60, I'd go play at a real poker game, like $60 to $300 buy-in range. And I would buy in for the minimum and just pray that something good would happen, you know. And once every 5 times, something good happened, and I thought I was the greatest. I've kind of, over the years, let's say the 6 years between 2004 and 2010, I had played quite a bit, and I thought, man, it sure would be nice. You know, everyone and anyone that plays will have this same sort of thing. Like, wow, it'd be great if I could, you know, make a living doing this. And everyone kind of has it in the back of their mind. And I decided I was going to try and go for it. So I started studying and playing, and I got extremely lucky one night in December, where I won $32,000 in Blackhawk. They had some extremely large bad beat jackpots back in this era. And so this was no skill of my own. I was literally sitting there picking my nose, not doing anything. I was out of the hand, and two other people got in a big hand, and all of a sudden everyone was getting paid. This was a $750,000 jackpot. The loser of the hand, the quote loser of the hand, got $350,000. The winner of the hand would have gotten probably half of that. And that was my seed money to get to Las Vegas, where I spent 7.5 years. Back in 2010, 2011, 2012, after the housing crash, things were extremely cheap. I bought a condo for $23,000 and change with taxes and everything.
Okay, so now our competitive gambling adventure has moved from Colorado Springs to Las Vegas. I asked Jeremy to fill in a few more of the more granular dots of how Las Vegas leads to a table.
I won my way in the first time. I played a $525 tournament. So I won this tournament, and they give you $10,000 in what they call lammers, which are tournament chips, but they're only good for tournaments. So you can't cash them in. They have no cash value. However, you can sell these to other players. So I certainly could have gotten 10,000 out of it if I wanted to. And there are thousands and thousands of players ready and willing to put up the 10,000. So, you know, they're going to pay 10,000 no matter what. So if you can't find friends who will pay you full price, you can certainly find someone who will pay you $9,900 or something to that effect. So if you need the cash, if you don't want to risk it all, you certainly can sell your lammers at the World Series of Poker. During the World Series of Poker, nearly every day I would go to the Rio. I would play small tournaments, maybe a $125 entry tournament. They would have, for instance, you could play that with 10 players, and the winner would get $1,000 in lammers and a little bit of cash. I don't remember if I paid cash or if I used lammers to enter this $525 tournament, but this is a tournament that takes a few hours. Let's say maybe 4 to 5 hours, I would guess.
Okay.
And basically 1 in 20 people approximately will get into the next round, maybe 1 in 21 players. So you have to do quite well to make it to the end. And I had won a lot of chips, so many, in fact, that I was certain, although I really shouldn't have been, and at this point, I honestly would laugh at my past self for being overconfident. I definitely should have been babysitting my chips a little more and making sure people weren't stealing from me. But I just left the table, the room, bragging, telling people, I'm not going to screw this one up. I've got too many chips. I don't need to do anything, and I'm going to get in. And I was quite certain of this for, I'm not sure how long, long enough to tell my uncle and a couple of friends that I was doing very well, and I was sure I was a lock. But then by the time I wandered back to the table, I started sweating. I was like, oh no, what if this guy doubles up? And then that guy doubles up again. And what if this guy waits and doesn't play anything for the next hour, and I have to pay the blinds 3 more times? I made it to day 3. And on the first 2 days, I was doing quite well. I was, I believe, top 10 in chips for the latter part of day 1 and most of day 2, probably until after dinner break on day 2. So, you know, that's a nice place to be. Yeah, I murdered it for the first 2 days, and I was kind of leading up to this story. I was about to say, coincidentally, the person who Chris Moneymaker beat in 2001, I think it was Sammy Farha, if I'm not mistaken, whom I eliminated on the first day.
So as this particular tournament bore out, our friend Jeremy Lanosga does not finish in the money, but boy, he won a pile of stories along the way. And this is something very interesting. That was by no means the end of him as a poker player. And he hinted at the end of our talk that he had even better stories than that. So, Jeremy, I just want to thank you for indulging my curiosity, your willingness to just jump on the phone with me and indulge my, you know, curiosity and be transparent and wise and funny about the whole thing. There you go. That was Jeremy's story about the WSOP in 2014. Track of the week is next. Hey, do you like organ samples? Do you like fun? Breakup Gaming Society's The Originals series continues, dedicated to rhymers who remain unmistakable from bar one. Today, we're going to have some fun with Drez from Black Sheep, who, as part of the Native Tongue cohort, brought new poetry, expression, and playfulness to the form. Native Tongues, you know, that's De La Soul, Jungle Brothers, A Tribe Called Quest, and some other loose allies, you know, was just brimming with poetic talent and mic skills. And in this constellation and others, Drez from Black Sheep still sounds like no other. Warm and cocky, playful and louche, his high register voice often interrupting rhythms with conversational and comedic pauses as he gloats in the most charming way possible about the rakish life of a young and handsome microphone artiste, whose life is currently bursting with too much fun, even if some of it is at your expense.
I do what I want and I answer to no one. I'll let you know. My favorite meal is anything with me. My favorite quote, can I have a receipt? My favorite show is Who's the Boss? And my favorite hoe is yours, of course.
I like how he finishes his last verse by telling you, it's okay to flip him off and be in on the joke. And each listen also gives me a deeper appreciation for the creamy thickness of DJ and producer Mr. Long's studio work on the chorus here.
Don't let nobody tell you what you cannot be. Don't let nobody tell you what you cannot do. Enough of the tours, it's time to get yours. Otherwise, I guess I have to give the finger to you. I know you wanna, you know you wanna. I know you wanna, you know you wanna. I know you wanna, you know you wanna. Give me the finger.
If you like Mr. Long's approach to a track, here's a bonus thing to go find. It's called Silence of the Lambs, The Instrumentals, Volume 1. If you just want to groove to his rich and frisky production style, if not, give me the finger. Episode 82 is a wrap. So next time around, the plan is to come back with deeper impressions on all of the big hits of summer. So for fall and winter, I'm also looking ahead. I'm acquiring a trio of Empire and War-themed games to give my mind something to chew on in its darker moments, which seem to last for days sometimes now that it's cold. It worked last February with Thunderbolt Apache Leader, so maybe if I triple up on the games and start before Thanksgiving, it'll be more therapeutic and effective. I'll look up, my face looking like a newly unearthed tuber, and see that it's March again. If you'd like to buy me a round during this worthy and necessary project, do consider hitting the donate page at breakupgamingsociety.com, where my cocktail booklet is waiting as a thank you for anybody who coughs up $10 or more. Till next time, this is the Colonel Hector Bravado in Starkville, Colorado, signing off. May you fight long and well.